Most of the history of life took place in the sea. Plants and animals started to colonize land only half a billion years ago. This sounds like a lot of time, but it is less than a fifth of the history of life on our planet. Sexual reproduction, of course, also evolved in the sea, and gametes are thus well suited to the marine environment. This adaptation enables the various organisms to release their gametes, eggs, and sperm into the sea. Gametes can float and swim and find and fertilize each other. This is called external fertilization.
These corals release into the water all of their reproductive materials. Egg and sperm bundles slowly float towards the sea surface, where they are getting carried away with the currents, breaking apart by the waves and forces of wind and currents, until finally sperm meets an egg, fertilize it, and new life emerge. Now, coral eggs, oocytes, remain viable for only a few hours. That means that if corals will not synchronize the spawning events in a very precise way, it will all go to waste. That is why these events of spawning in corals and other animals have to be highly synchronized. The most iconic phenomena and the most world-renowned phenomena of coral reproduction is, of course, the mass spawning event in the Great Barrier Reef of Australia. And the mass spawning, this term actually refers to an event in which literally dozens or more than 100 of different species spawn in exactly the same time, in the same hour of the night, and the same night, actually, in the week that follows the full moon in either November or December every year. This phenomena and timing and synchrony of corals can range from either the one extreme of the mass spawning event, again, all the community, all species of corals spawn in the exact same time, to the other extreme that can be found mostly in the Gulf of Eilat and Aqaba and the northern parts of the Red Sea. In here we have the complete other extreme in terms of synchrony of timing of those events, and that is the temporal reproductive isolation known from the Gulf of Eilat and Aqaba. And that means that every single species has its unique timing, whether it's the hour at night or the particular night of the month. This all being governed by a complex variety of environmental factors, such as the lunar phase and the seasonal changes in temperature and other environmental factors that eventually orchestrate this event to be highly synchronized in a very narrow time window. Some of the species are actually spawning only once a year. It's an annual cycle for a brief moment that may be only 5 minutes in a particular time of the night, in a very particular night.
Rather recent threat is that of light pollution. The reproductive cycle of corals, like that of many other reef denizens, is timed by the phases of the moon. Now, the light coming from nearby cities and installations upsets the control of reproduction by the natural cycle of the moonlight, and that interferes with coral reproduction.
External fertilization is not restricted to sessile animals, but can be found in many motile ones. For example, all fish use external fertilization. We see here Antias. The female chooses the male, and they swim side by side. The female releases the eggs, and the male his sperm.
Mass reproduction that is found among some fish here in the coral reef. Again, it was discovered here by researchers coming to Eilat from Florida and from Arizona, and they worked on a herbivorous fish called surgeon fish. It's dull-looking fish. It's sort of brownish, grayish fish, the size of a palm. And they are very abundant here. The role, ecological role, is very important because they graze out the algae from the reef and thereby allowing the corals to flourish. And then they noticed that towards the end of the day, all of a sudden they could see convoys of these fish swimming towards that direction. They followed these fish And then they discovered that the fish were navigating to these two sites, and at each site they form an aggregation of hundreds or even sometimes thousands of fish, and they start swirling. And once, almost before the last light of the day, all of a sudden they start swimming up, and while swimming up in a jerk, all the females release eggs, all the males release sperms, the water becomes white, totally white, and they repeat doing that, going up and going up and going up for about 10 to 15 minutes. Of course, many predators of eggs or plankton come there and have a really nice feast at the evening. As you can see in the movie, it's a vision that should not be missed. Surprisingly, 98% of the eggs are fertilized, which is amazing because it's all released to the water. Sperms have to find the eggs under free conditions of the water, but since it's aggregated and their fish are very dense in this aggregation, then 98% of the eggs are fertilized.
Conditions on land are not suitable for animal gametes. If an animal would secrete its gametes on land, they would die within a short time. Moreover, moving in air is completely different than swimming in water. Plants solve this by evolving extremely hardy pollen cells, as will be discussed in the last chapter. Animals, in contrast, evolved internal fertilization. This requires mating, a direct interaction between males and females. Male gametes are transferred into the female without neither gamete being exposed to the environment. As terrestrial animals, we are of course highly interested in mating, as seem to be these kangaroos here. The requirement for mating led to the evolution of a fascinating array of anatomical and behavioral mechanisms. Mating has the additional advantage that gametes are directly delivered to the destination. This advantage holds also in the sea. Indeed, mating evolved independently also in various marine animals. In some of them, like dolphins and whales, that evolved from land animals, mating is, like their dependence on breathing air, part of the terrestrial heritage. There are, however, also animals that never left the sea that use internal fertilization. In this stunning video, shot by Tom Schlesinger, we see two octopuses mating. The male sends one of his 8 tentacles and inserts his sperm into the mantle of the female. Sharks are another marine group that never went on land and that fertilizes by mating.
Hello, I'm here with Anna. Anna is a guide here at the observatory and she's going to talk about sharks and sharks reproduction.
My name is Anna Ostrovsky. I'm part of the guiding team here in the park. I'm working here for around 2 years. I'm a student for life sciences at the Open University.
We're right now at the sharks pool at the park. In this pool we can see 5 different species of sharks that all of them we can find right here in the Red Sea. Most of them are actually open water sharks, just like this beauty over here. Most of the open water sharks, especially of course the males, have 2 reproduction organs because they need to approach the female from her side. They cannot stop for the reproduction itself because open water sharks do not have a muscle to breathe while resting, so they have to be in motion all of the time. So they eat while in motion, sleep while in motion, and of course mate while in motion. They approach the female from the side and one of the reproduction organs goes to the side needed. Of course the stingrays and the eagle rays actually reproduce pretty much the same way because they're the same family. The female cannot give birth to more than one little shark at a time because they actually eat one another and the womb of the mother. So most of the times there will be only one baby shark, in extreme cases no more than 2. When the shark gives birth, she needs to be as far away as possible from other sharks because sharks usually feed on injured, sick or dying animals. So the smell of giving birth can attract a lot of other predators, which the female of course wants to avoid. Unlike the open water sharks, actually the sand sharks, just like the leopard shark we have over here, they're pretty much the only ones that lay eggs. They lay between 2 2 to 3 eggs, cover them near the coral reef and swim away. After several months, between 2 to 3 months, the eggs will hatch.